Hatep Yasar. Today we are here gathered another Friday for question and answer class, but we as Nuwaupians, proud Nuwaupians, stand squarely on Wu-nuwaup and do what our master teacher has always done, which is answer the questions of our people. First, we want to make sure we stand and proclaim the innocence of our master teacher as always, and also the inevitable freedom that comes along with his freedom from this unjust holding of his body, as well as our unjust being held mentally and culturally speaking, but we have been given our culture back, so we are here to represent that on today. So, as a student teacher, my name is Sermitutsi Tepkhaut, and with that being done, anybody who has any questions, the microphone is here, please step forward. Not everybody all at one time.
Hatep, brother.
Hatep there, brother. How you doing?
Good. Does the kaka soup particularly have a seasoning for certain beans that they choose? Is it like a certain seasoning that they prefer?
What when you say seasoning, what are you referring to?
I'm referring to what if
are we talking about paprika? What are we talking about? When you say a certain seasoning.
I'm like for the beans that they eat. Certain ones they won't eat.
Oh, you're talking about kalkasu. Wait. So you're talking about the beings who actually eat kalkasu.
Yeah.
Okay, so you're talking about the kalkasu's overlords, who would be your Kamahu or your Pleiadians, mm-hmm. and the Anunnaki who overrule them.
Cool.
Okay, all right. What it is within their genetics, or the genetics of the Pleiadians, as we've been taught, our master teacher has explained, that when you're dealing with those particular beings, they are a wicked being. They have a concentration of six ether that's within their DNA. And then those reptilians known as the Mushafu, let me spell it out for you. Hafu, from that word Zahaf, you're talking about evil reptilians. These are the ones who need blood within their system in order to eat. As our master teacher explained, you are what you eat. So these beings, being wicked in nature themselves, evil in nature themselves, disagreeable in nature themselves, they have to eat something, and they have to have a substance that promotes that within their diet. So therefore, they have to eat these Pleiadians and these Outer Barons who have that within their nature, that six ether force, the level where they are, right? So, therefore, being that Pleiadians were used to create these albino beings here on this planet now that we know as Mukasu, or the Caucasoids, the Caucasians on this planet, right, with the leprosy and everything else, within their genetics, right, that six ether force within them, and then that nature, their nature, that's what's a part of their seasoning within themselves, which puts them on the menu for these beings, the Mushafu, that we commonly know as or refer to as Anunnaki, who eat them because that was the reason that they were actually even created. One of the reasons they were created to eat, as well as created to work for the beings who came down in Mesopotamia and actually started up those three monotheistic religions, or they started the religions that came from Hinduism onto Zoroastrianism, and then became, you know, your Hebrewism, or your Mosesism, your Jesusism, and your Muhammadism. You follow? So you're dealing with Mushafu, or evil reptilian beings who are above all of that, and because of what's inside of the genes is what they have an affinity towards for their own diet, because they need that within their diet. As our math teacher also explained, that's the reason why you haven't been commonly used to hearing Nubians being abducted for food because they don't want to take positive beings up to eat because you are what you eat. And they're not positive in that sense. So therefore, we're not on the menu. Now, the trick that's been going on is they found out what's been going on with themselves as well. So just like the Pleiadians before them, who decided, okay, we better make somebody that can be a substitute for us to be the quote unquote other white meat, right? They said, since we have to do that, we want to, you know, because the first law is self-preservation, right? So they want to preserve themselves. So their offspring has that same feeling now. They want to preserve themselves. So one of the ways they try to preserve themselves is by tying into our genetics, being a superior genetic being on this planet, right? But also by getting you to actually bring your 9-ether vibratory level down to the 6-ether level. And then that would then put you on the menu as well. Because now, as the math teachers explained, you begin to smell like them. You know, you move like them, you act like them, and then what's permeating from inside of you genetically would be basically you being a black person on the outside, but actually a Caucasoid by your DNA now, because you've taken on so much that's brought your frequency that far down. You follow? So that's what's a part of them that makes them be a part of the menu of these overlords of theirs. If that answers your question. All right. How's that, brother?
Yeah, I want to know what the fascination is with Egypt. So everybody's like,
what's the fascination with Egypt?
Why is it so special?
All right.
It's fascinating.
It's fascinating, number one. Let's just be clear. You always say we give credit where credit is due, right? First and foremost, when it comes down to ancient civilizations, when you look at what's being commonly referred to as Egypt, ours is one of the only places where you still see full-out culture on display, you follow, and it's displaying all of the things that our ancestors have done, right? It's being referred to as Egypt by Greeks or what have you, but we've called it by many different names, Tamaray, or Hutkapatai, Hutbapatai, or some people say Hemet or Haman, right? Because of what our ancestors have been able to give to civilization around the world, number one, makes it important for everybody to see. Everybody wants to write about us, but it's also the birthplace of all the other knowledge which was given to other cultures around the world. When you talk about your Greeks and your Romans and those, they had to actually come down and learn from Egyptians, if we're using that phrase, Egyptians. So therefore, that's why Washington, D.C. is built with so many different monuments that basically give an ode to our own ancestors. When you're dealing with obelisks, that comes with us first. That comes from our people first. When you're dealing with pyramids, that comes from our people first. So that's one of the number one reasons why it's so important to, and it's so it makes people so curious, one. Also, the fact that they took so much and they carbon copied from these places that they learned at, for instance, like our math teacher explained to us before, we're here in America, right? Being here in America, we know that the major religion here in America is Christianity, right? Our math teacher explained, the first Christian church is what church?
Catholic.
The Catholic church, right? He explained, when you even look at the word Catholic, said when you see it, you see how it's broken up. You see that it's got cat as a word, and then it's got holy as a word, which comes from the word whole or hell, which is holy. So it's saying holy cat, which is referring back to our Pavruti, or what they call the Sphinx, right? And then if you look at the way the Catholic Church is set up in their worship of the different saints, right, the patron saint of this, that, and whatever else, and you see the way that they have statues of these particular saints, right, and then you see in the Vatican where they have obelisks on the outside, which they call Cleopatra's Needle, right, when you see that they have literally taken a carbon copy of our way of life, changed faces, and put it into their own to say that this is us, but they're still, all the way down to their Black Madonna, like you see right here, when you see Aset, holding hard, It's the same that they literally stole her, put a white face on it once it got out here, but yet those amongst them still know that she's actually black. The actual person that they got this from is black. So the fascination really is that they understand that that's the source of all of their knowledge. So that's why they're most fascinated with our ancestors in Africa as a whole. Egypt, to be more specific for what they like to say, because they like to try to take Egypt out of Africa. That's why I keep saying, if we want to say the word Africa, or Egypt, excuse me. Does that?
Yeah, but the reason I was asking is like, you know, they've been over there for hundreds of years digging, and they still over there digging looking for stuff. Like,
oh, yeah.
Why y'all not in the Caucasus Mountains digging for stuff?
Right.
But y'all still in Egypt, they trying to take everything out there, they still digging.
It's interesting that you would say that. The master teacher explained, when it comes down to Mesopotamia and Africa, those are the only places where they're looking for things and finding things. And as a matter of fact, in Mesopotamia, they found so much things that they want to destroy them. This is the purpose for all of the wars and everything that they're doing over there, because they really want to destroy these relics, which would tell of their true story.
So you would have to explain it, either.
They don't want to go into the Caucasus Mountains and explain how they actually became who and what they are, because the story that they would get, or that they would have to admit, would be that they've slept with dogs, they've been a grafted being, they're not even a natural being. They'd have to admit to all of these things. So they have to destroy stories that show who they really are. Because remember, for this last 6,000 year period, they've been going around pretending to be someone that they're not. Just like they pretend to be the original Egyptians through, Charlton Heston,
Cleopatra,
and through Elizabeth Taylor and all of them. They pretend to be who we are. So it's fascinating to them. First off, we're fascinating to them. So that's what fascinates them first. Then you see that we have all the evidence of who and what we are there. It's written in stone. It's on the walls. They keep coughing up more and more of our ancestors to give proof that we indeed exist. But yet when you go and ask them the same questions about their religious deities and their patriarchs and everything else, you ask them to give that same amount of evidence, and they don't have it because it's not there.
You follow? I feel that. Because I find it interesting, right, how they've managed to copy everything we do, the way we sing, the way we dance. Their women now found
ways.
Women have found ways to be built like us through cosmetic surgery, but the only thing they can't copy is the hair.
Yeah. But I bet they're going to try.
They're going to try.
Yeah. How's that, Elder?
My question is, why is the God of the Bible sometimes wrathful and other times merciful?
Okay.
That's like human emotions.
Exactly. Give me one moment. Whoa! All right. One of the things that's not taught in religion as we've known it is that with the name that they like to commonly refer to as God, mm-hmm. that's just a three-letter word. That's just a title given. Right. That actual word is not from a Greek origin, nor from a Hebrew origin, mm-hmm. but rather from a German origin, from the word "gut," meaning good. So that becomes the first hurdle that we have to jump over when it comes down to speaking to our people about God first, because their mentality about who or what God is has to change first.
Right.
Right? So when we go and we look into the Hebrew, you have different names or attributes such as El or Elion, Elion El, or El Shaddai, mm-hmm. for instance. Each of these different attributes are being given or being attributed to one three-letter word, G-O-D, God.
Okay.
But for anyone who speaks these different languages, they understand that these are actually attributes that are showing there's separation of beings being talked about. So in Genesis 1:1, for instance, mm-hmm. when they say in the beginning God, the Hebrew word there is Elohim,
okay.
right? That's Strong's number 430. It shows that that is a plural word, because you put that yod and that meme on the end of it. So it takes the word Elo, changes it to Elohim. Just like if I say chair as one, then I say chairs as many or more than one. right? It says more than one of these beings, these Elohs, if you would, right? Mm-hmm. So many times what's happening is you'll have one being who feels merciful to a situation, right? But then you have another being who's wrathful. But what we know is that the stories of Mesopotamia that have fallen into what we call Christianity, Judaism, and Islam are actually all stories which got their roots from out of Sumerian stories, such as your Enuma Elish and your Atrahasis and things of that nature. So you have a story of, or you have an account rather, of two brothers that actually didn't see eye to eye, being Enki and Enlil. Mm-hmm. So many of the times when you're seeing the story, right, one of those beings is actually being agreeable towards the beings on the planet at the time, while the other one totally has a disregard for them and wants to destroy them. So that's why it seems that God, if people were looking at it as just being one being, it seems that this particular being is schizophrenic, mm-hmm. right? So it's like, how can he say, you know, don't do this now, but then he turn around and he do it. You say, I'll never do that again, and then you turn around and kill everybody, right? So going into our teaching and our way as Patarak, just to give you some more clarity, and those that's with us on the internet, we need to understand that it wasn't just one group of beings coming to the planet. So I'll go to Patarak Sarabu Karabu to kind of give you a little bit more. Verse 29 says, many came to this planet from afar, from Andromeda, from Pleiades, from Orion, from Sirius, from Drago, from Aldebaran, from Arcturus, from Zeta Reticuli, from Ilion, and many others, some sub-beings or grafted beings. Some were good and agreeable, while others were bad and disagreeable. Some ate all kinds of flesh, even Homo sapiens flesh, yet there was order. That's verses 29 to verse 42. And the purpose of me reading that is to explain many times what we're getting as a watered down thing here in religion is really giving account of different beings from different places having encounters with each other. It's not all one being up under this three letter umbrella word, G-O-D, God. Mm-hmm. And that's where the confusion comes in.
Okay. So the average lay person has to figure through all of that
if we were to put it in the average lay person's terms, which is, it's interesting that you even say that, because religion teaches us not to take responsibility. Mm-hmm. Religion teaches us that if it's good for us, God did it. If it's bad for us, the devil did it, right? But here in Wu-nuwaup, we've been taught by our master teacher that the helping hand that we're looking for is on the end of our own arm.
Right.
So he explained, okay, I'm teaching you, but it's your responsibility to be a diligent student. Mm-hmm. It's your responsibility to be a true seeker of this knowledge. So therefore, you'll be able to put those pieces together for yourself. But as we've been taught inside of our holy tablets, it explained, before we can show ourselves able to move forward with our sun cycle right now, we'd have to be able to pass a capability test. One of those things would be to reject the oppressor's religion and the spirit names and all of that. So that becomes like one of the first steps. So when we turn around and we say, okay, go and do your research, don't believe us, check it out. Mm-hmm. Go and look up Strong's number 430 to see that the word is Elohim. And that immediately says that, okay, there's more than one God. Mm-hmm. Your whole life you were taught through Christianity or Islam or what have you, that there's only one God. But then you've been blinded to a way to where, even though it says, okay, I'm a jealous God or I'm the most high God and things of that nature, how can you be the most of anything if there's only one you? How can you be jealous if there's nothing for you to be jealous of? And then you turn around and take other pieces of evidence and you show, such as the simple thing for us, which is to look up that Strong's reference number, mm-hmm. 430, and you go to Psalms 82, and you see it says that God, still saying Elohim, mm-hmm. sits in the council of the mighty and judges amongst the gods. Most Christians don't even know that their religion is actually a polytheistic religion based on their own words of their own Bible. So as our master teacher has taught us, we have to go into these books and then we have to open them up and get meaning for words, because he says through meaning you'll be able to find reasoning. Mm-hmm. So that's what the average layperson would have to do. The average layperson would have to stop laying and stand, you know? That's what would have to happen.
Okay.
You follow? Right. Because, see, we accept average. Mm-hmm. We accept mediocrity. But genetically, we're not. Mm-hmm. We accept being less than what we actually are. But we have to find, you know, the steps to start bringing ourselves up. And that's what our master teacher has come to do. Mm-hmm. That's why he answers people's questions on the level that they're at.
Right.
That's why we went through all those schools of religion so that we would be able to raise up. He said, I came to give you what you wanted. Mm-hmm. So you would then learn to want what I came to give. You know? Right. And that's what we were all lay people, but look at us now. Mm-hmm. You follow? Like right. People are amazed at how we've been able to amass so much information. But it's because we've got a master guiding us through it.
Right.
That's you follow?
Okay. Appreciate that.
Appreciate you, Elder. And then after this one, I'm going to pass it over to my good brother, Amon Ray Atun.
Hatep. Earlier you spoke about, or you answered the brother's question about the seasoning. And you mentioned things like Palladians and Anunnaki and Kakasu being on the menu.
Mm-hmm.
Is that what is meant in the Bible or the scriptures when it mentions all throughout the scriptures God loving the savory scent of blood, the sweet scent of blood, all throughout the scripture, all throughout the Bible you have references to sacrifices being made and for what purpose, and God, for whatever reason, loving the smell of burning flesh, the scent of savory blood. Mm-hmm. Does that tie into what you were describing for the or explaining to the brother earlier?
It totally ties in, and so we'll jump into it real quick. For instance, as we were talking about the names or attributes of these beings, right? You have one name that is used for the being inside of Christianity that they call El Shaddai, right? El Shaddai. Right, inside of this word Shaddai, you see the word El and you see Shad as that root of that word, right? See, the word Shad goes to Hebrew Strong's number 7700. And its translation, or its closest translation is to English, means demon. I had a conversation with a brother, and he was trying to convert me to Christianity, but it was like I was already converted to Christianity before, and I gave it back, you know. And so you're trying to bring me back into the fold, I guess, or whatever. But I explained, I said, well, do you know the names of this being that you're saying that I'm supposed to serve, right? And he was like, you know, it doesn't matter, you know, so many names, and, you know, I'm spiritual, I've seen the spirit move in church and all this other good stuff, you know. And I said, please, you know, respectfully, spare me the cliches, and let's just deal with what you know and what you don't know about it. He explained to me that, yeah, there are mistakes as far as language and all of this and all of that, but we have to do our best to translate what we read for ourselves so that we'll be able to know. So I asked him a simple question. I said, well, what is a demon to you? He told me that to him, a demon is an evil spirit. So then I walked him through and I showed him I said, do you agree that one of the names for your God is El Shaddai, right? And he said, yeah, we agree. So then I showed him how the root of the word means demon and how the word El means mighty, right? So I said, so now that you know that one of the attributes of your God is my mighty demon, how do you feel? And he said, I'm taking it out of context. I said, how am I taking definition out of context? Because what they'll do is they'll tell you that Shaddai means almighty. They'll take you to Hebrew Strong's number 7706 is what they'll take you to, right? And they'll say it means almighty.
And they'll say, once again, like when I was talking to the elders a second ago, they'll say, El Shaddai means Almighty God. It's one of the favorite things preachers say. Now, how you gonna bring the word God into this? Because I was always taught, right, that you can't define a word with the word. So if you said that El Shaddai means God, because you don't see El Shaddai inside of a Christian Bible anywhere, you see God, Lord, you know, see, you see Lord, you see God. So how can you take a word that's translated as God, and then when you see El Shaddai, you turn around and you see it as Almighty God, how can you define it with the word that you first translated it into just as being God? That doesn't make sense. Then when you see the root of it, it means demon. Another word that they get when you're talking about the word Shad is from another word Shud in there as well. That's Hebrew Strong's number 7703. And it means to ruin, to destroy, spoil, to devastate. So when you're looking at this, if you have a mind to reason, you say, this being is claiming to be almighty by way of his devastation and destruction. This being is a demon. So, when you go further back and you look into those Sumerian stories that are teaching us about Ba'anunnaki, you find that these beings were at war with each other. They had disagreements with each other. And what also happened is they were also fighting for allegiance of the beings that they had grafted on the planet. So you had different beings saying, look, I'm the most mighty. You had Enlil up in the mountains talking to those Caucasoids saying, I'm the most mighty. I'm the one that you're supposed to serve. I'm jealous. Don't make an image of nothing that lives up under the water. Don't make an image of nothing that lives on land or anything like that. And the reason why he was teaching this to them is because he wanted to remain in control of them. He wants to control his food. You follow? It's the same thing that farmers do to this day if they have cows. They put them inside of a fence. They don't just let them go where they want to go. They got to keep them in control. Because I want to know where my food is when it's time for me to go ahead and, you know, have a barbecue.
Yes.
You know?
So is this why the Nuwapic doctrine teaches about the spell or a spell? Is that part of ignoring what most religious people or Christians do, ignoring what's right in front of them? Exactly what they see, such as El Shaddai and the words, and then you refer to the Hebrew Strong's and you get the word demon, and then yet you translate it into, like you just said, Almighty God, when it actually says demon. Mm-hmm. Same thing with the very word amen or amen.
Uh-huh.
And finding it in the Hebrew Strong's as well. And it's actually the root word of an ancient Egyptian deity. Is this why the Nuwapic doctrine teaches about a spell that was placed on the minds of the people because of ignoring what's exactly in front of you?
Okay. Let me see if I can. You said, is this why our doctrine teaches of the 6,000 year spell of ignorance?
Or is this part of the spell in itself, pretty much having it explained, described and actually shown words such as amen for Amun, an Egyptian deity, El Shaddai, demon, and translating on. Is this part of what ties into the spell?
Exactly. What we'll do is we'll put it into this terminology, right, or an analogy term. We have a doctor. We've been sick. We've been infected. The infection has been ignorance. Ignorance is not knowing, but ignorance is also ignoring the facts. So we've been infected with a disease of ignorance. We have a doctor who comes with the formula in which to heal us, right? And in the healing of us is us becoming no longer ignorant but aware, right? So now we know. So the pill is in the books, right? The formula is in the books. And it's a result of the fact that we've been infected with that ignorance. And us having to go back and do this for other brothers and sisters to the best of our ability is a result of what we were taught, because he had to do that for us. So we're just continuing what he's done for us already. That's our job. Each one teach one.
Correct. But right? Is that also a part of that spell of sleep?
Of course.
Ignoring what's exactly in front of you.
Hey, what's so crazy about it is, it's exactly that, because you can show people this a lot of times all day long. see that ignorance, remember, ignorance has two definitions that our math teachers taught us. One definition of ignorance is not knowing, but then the other definition is ignoring the facts. When you go to a patriarch called the argument, the math teacher explained that there are people who just want to argue. We can ask them the question, do you actually speak Hebrew? Do you speak Greek? Does your pastor speak Hebrew? Does your pastor speak Greek? If the answer is no, then, and you don't just want to argue, you'll have to say, I've never read what it actually said. I don't actually know what it says. You'd have to admit that. But because of our ignorance, they won't admit that fact. They'll ignore that. That's a fact.
It's hard to first accept what you're saying and remove the blockage and then admit where, you know, that you're actually wrong and what you've learned and what was taught and programmed is actually wrong for all these years.
Nobody likes to admit that they've been fooled. Our math teacher told us, with all the information that we received, right, we started off beating people up with it, basically. Because we had so much and nobody could stand with us. They could stand toe to toe with us on a religious level. So what was happening is we were beating people up with information, right? And so that was making people be so afraid, they would build a fence up so high they just couldn't listen to us no more. So he explained, he said, no, you can't just take the floor from up under. You know, he said, you gotta actually be kind of, you gotta be gentle with that, right? Because here's an analogy. It's a patriarch called Patriarch the Diamond. This is where I kind of get this analogy from. They've got something that's of value to them in their homes now, because somebody gave it to them and told them that it was a diamond. But it's, once you study and you become a mineralogist, you can look at it and you know that it's actually not real, right? So you might go into their house and you see something that's there and it's not real. But it doesn't matter to them that it's not real because it's valuable to them because they received it from, like, I got Christianity from my mom. I got Christianity from my dad, my grandma, and this was my daddy's church, you know, and I saw all this stuff happening in the church. So their emotions are connected to that thing. When you start talking to them about it, it's like you can't just go and destroy them and just take it away from them. You actually got to be giving them something as you're giving them the information, which now gives them the ability to then get rid of it themselves. That's what he's done for us. He said, I came giving you what you wanted so that you would learn to want what I came to give. So now once we've learned so much, we put that Jesus that we used to hold, or that Muhammad that we used to hold, or that Allah that we used to hold in such high regard, we literally, within our own temple, our own house, we've been able to take it off the mantle place because we recognize this is garbage. And once we recognize that, we put it down. We understand we're the center of our own universe. We understand we're the ones who control our fate, and that's the way of our ancestors. So our values change.
Even if you do something as simple or as important as refer someone to, let's say, the Hebrew Strongs and show them where you can find the actual definitions of all of these root words that is mentioned in their Bible, their holy books, their Quran, many simply won't even do that. They won't even refer to other references that will actually give them the actual meaning and definition of the root words that they're actually believing and accepting blindly. Is it a thing where...
Do you find that?
Is it easier?
Do you find that?
I have found it.
Yeah.
So is it easier as a whole for people to simply follow whatever the reverend or the pastor say without doing any type of research?
They've been geared towards that, and that's easier. Responsibility comes with the knowledge that you have. So once you gain more knowledge, you have a level of responsibility. You now have to be in the driver's seat. You follow. You know that you're responsible. You know that it's not some spook god that's doing this or that. You know that it's you. You follow? All right. So that suffice. All right. And with that, I'm going to pass the class over to my good brother, Amon Reatun. Tamus Katha.
That's it. You have any more questions?
Do Can you explain triple darkness as it relates to the womb of a female and also as it relates to pre-incarnation of the Nagato race?
Ooh, that's a very good question. one second. Okay. Give me a second. What was the second part?
The second part was also as it relates to the pre-incarnation of the Nagato race.
As it relates to the reincarnation?
Pre-incarnation
of the Nagato race?
For the actual incarnation of the Nagato race, the triple darkness state.
Well,
and the first part was as it relates to a womb of a female.
All right. Basically, the first part of your question, Padmabhabhi Anun explained to us years ago, this book right here called The Birth Ceremony goes into it pretty well, also inside of the Black Book, Sacred Records of Atum Re. It's talking about the three trimesters of a woman's birth. And basically he explained, he said, we're looking at it in its reality forms. The first trimester being that what you see within the womb is actually dealing with a reptilian form. You'll see the reptile form, which be our true nature as aquatic beings on this planet. And being that the womb is actually full of water and that fetus is actually formed with inside of an egg. They won't say an egg, but they'll say, once the baby's born, they'll say the water broke. You follow? Also, too, if you do any research, if you have time, you could also probably Google it, but you can also go to the Atlantic Zoo, and you'll see that it has in the serpent or reptile section of the zoo, it has a diagram of a female and a diagram of a reptilian. And you'll see that the internal organs are lined up the same. All right. The second trimester, he said, it would be as a gray. And you'll see that also, you'll see pictures of that fetus as it's growing. You'll see the big black round eyes. The head is extremely big, you know what I'm saying, so forth. Also, you'll know that within our development, you know, even as mostly you'll see it in children, you probably remember it yourself, taking long baths or so forth, standing under the water long enough, you get buoyancy within the skin, you know, or bubbles or air pockets, basically, you know. The third trimester would be in our human state, our human form that we're in now. And that somewhat brings into the reality of our before factor into now. You'll see those different stages of different extraterrestrial, interceptions of genetic development that took place periodically throughout our growth or our development, as they planted the seeds within the water, as you know, for us to grow as tides. But in time, you know what I'm saying, as he showed it, he went more into depth. And I'm gonna let the brother Sermitut, he call it, explain some of which he has learned recently.
Alright, one more. Going towards your second part of the question, where you asked, "When? How does it have a pertinence to our creation as beings?" And the way it sounds, you said pre-incarnation. So I'm assuming I shouldn't do that. But I guess that means you're talking about before we were created in the physical, right? Okay. You see right here on the wall? See how we have these three new bowls right here? So I'm asking you to explain, when you're seeing those new bowls in what they're calling the hieroglyphs, right? And excuse me, because I can't draw. Don't laugh at my drawing. Not too much. All right. With these three new bowls, right, they represent space, time and material. Right? They represent also the three stages in the womb, like what my brother was explaining, right? But these particular things had to be made in order to create the place for this physical matter to come through. So, when we go to the holy tablets, give me 1 second to pull this up, okay?
Okay.
See, before we actually, the master said in the beginning was, he said in the beginning was the word. He said that word was existence. He said, and that came before creation. So beings already existed on different levels and dimensions that we don't have a comprehension of as of this moment. But they had to create the space in which to create the material. So that's why when you see those three nubos in that triple darkness, they had to create that before they created the material that would exist within it. They had to create the place to put it first. You understand? But let me follow this up. I'll make sure I open up these tablets for you. But this has been in some of the most up-to-date information that's been given. And in the notes from that particular class, he explained that, let me just read some of the notes so you have it direct. All right. And that's funny. It says, Nuwaupians, this is the mental and ethereal science of nine nus, the nine mind. And the new mind, he spelled it in you, as in like the new bowls, right? He said, news of the new cycle of the emotions of natural nature, reason. And since reason is intelligence, madat, word, and intelligence power, Wu-nuwaupu, and sound gives shape and form from space, time, and material, symbolized by three bowls in the ancient hieroglyphics, which were the three stages in the womb. He put space, time, and material, and then up under it he put nun. As you see here, that's a hieroglyph for Nun right there, or Anun, right? It says, personifying the primeval waters out of which emerged the creator, Ptah. So in ancient Egyptian account of Ptah and inside the sacred records of Atum Re, where it also explains that Ptah created while standing on Ma'at, and then he utilized the power of Hu, Psi and Hika in order to create. This is the ontology of what was being done. And as I don't know if you know, I don't want to assume, but when ontology, they put ontology into a category of being a metaphysical science, of being the study of the nature and existence of all things. That's why the master explained that we are ontologists. You refer to Nuwaupians ontologists of time. Okay, so our, and also not just that, but the actual fact, what number is it? Is it 30? Ontology is mythology? Is Egyptian ontology mythology?
I forget which number.
Is Egyptian ontology mythology? It explains that what they looked at as our stories being mythological story was actually high science explaining what their scientists are just now starting to get bits and pieces of or glimpses of, but our ancestors put it into a story form so that we will be able to, you know, be taught by these signs and symbols. And anybody who knows, you know, knows that, you know, when it comes down to symbols, there are those who are taught to be able to see the symbols for what they are. And I said all of that while I wait to find this particular part. Okay, here's one part so that you can kind of see. It says, let me start by telling you about the beings that existed trillions of earth years ago. This is Holy Tablets, chapter 1, tablet 1, starting at verse 4 right now. It says, let me start by telling you about the beings that existed trillions of earth years ago. Before the Precambrian period, before you human beings were created in the physical form upon the planet Tiamat, now called Earth, we also know as Ptah Nun, from the word Iridu, there existed supreme beings of pure green light, ethereal, and sub-supreme beings of the impure amber light, fire,
You cannot fully comprehend their beginnings because their time zone is much greater than your ability to comprehend at this point. Yet this very tablet which you are holding in your hand will open your eyes to their time zones that are in and beyond space. All right, give me 1 second again. And that was verse 4 through 4 and 5. Nuwaku informs you that there were three creations. This is now starting at verse 13. Nuwaupu informs you that there were three creations, original or primary creation, from the word primarius, from primus, first. Before the lightest atom, hydrogen, energies existed as a form of energy, existing in the form of gases. Nine levels of them, from quarks to biabs to zeds, zelies referred to as subatomic energy, before weight or the sum of any weight, registering as nothingness yet existing, being lighter than the first form of existence, hydrogen. Secondary or evolutionary creation, the evolving of existence from density to matter, to atoms, to cells, to organisms, to body, and or to bodies. And tertiarius, from tertius, third or gestational creation, the breath of life, the living soul, the existing conscious being. Primary creation was performed by non-ether beings, simply etherians, whose science is Nuwaupu. Non-ether represents birth. Conception as in nine, and birth, or the sum total of numbers. There are no numbers actually higher than nine. Nuwaupu means to convey a message that results in sound right reasoning, so there must be a conveyor and a listener to the message. The message is life, and the conveyor is existence. Three sets of three, or triple darkness. First set, before light, before energy, before matter. Second set, before time, before space, before place. Third set, before body, before soul, before spirit. So right there inside of Holy Tablets, chapter 1, tablet 1, you go into further explanation, or you get more explanation that goes along with what the Safaf or the hieroglyphs also show, being that they created these bowls or these places in order to create the space, the time, and then the material. But they existed before this. So they had to create that which they were going to create in. But like you said, that those were the beings who were creating, but they were existing on a level that's higher than our comprehension ability at this moment, or at this point. You follow?
That provided clarity. So in other words, before everything materialized in the physical, it existed, it was conceived beforehand and then existed in a different state before it actually physically manifested.
Yeah, it was basically what you're looking at is that science, the way they explain things in the Caucasian mentality and their, I guess their state of education, as to say, is really, it's adolescent. It's not, you know what I'm saying, in the sense of how we thought and how we did things. Of course, within their science school or community, they have magazines that update you in the latest science, but within the school curriculum, which the majority of us go by, you know, and don't even have an interest in our DNA or how we even formed, they will not involve this type of science or technical knowledge that actually predates their knowledge of today within their schooling. But you're looking at subatomic nature, but it's also dealing with the fact of it predates their creation. So it becomes like he taught us in the first stages of us maturing and broadening our minds, mythology versus factology. You know, so you're looking at, okay, first he had to give us their biblical stories and let us extinguish all of our desire of questioning and any opening or gap that they may have in their stories, any holes in their stories, let us find those. Then it was to say, well, who is this by language? Who are these people? Who are these beings? Which was known as what? Elohim. So they had to go into that. Then when you have things such as where he's explaining of the dust of the ground, or he blew the breath into the nostrils of man and man became a living soul. Well then, how is it that man already existed before he became a living soul? You get what I'm saying? So he had to let us see that there was creation, there was existence before creation. Or God had to come and step onto dry land. So there was some type of experimentation or some type of development or some type of science mind probing into the planet before the planet was even formed. And then it said it was planted. Everything was planted. By being planted, then that means that this was like a scientist, as so such a gardener or a farmer who has to be a scientist. Because they have to know the timings of nature, when the rain falls, when it doesn't, when to pick, when it's ripe, you know what I'm saying, so forth. Same way with our births and the maturity of our minds. So at different points when you had interceding on the ecology of the planet, on developing a mind state from a homogenous to a homo erectus, and then on an leaping of genes into a homo sapien, that was a big gap that scientists could not, you know, add the pieces to. They had to keep going by archaeologists and finding dates and times and so forth and relics to actually prove that some type of beings were here. But when you even go further and you probe even further, like you said, our skin, we're not as solid as we think we are. If you probe even further, you'll find that we're porous and blood cells and so forth. And then when you start tapping into DNA, RNA, you find out these things are living. You know, these are small entities encased in a bigger being called an entity, just like you have Mother Earth and Galatea, or the galaxy of Galaxia, and you have, you know, the universe. You know, and then he explains that whatever is going on in our system, as far as they call this a solar plexus, like a solar system, and everything revolves around it, because once the heat of the body is gone, then what? Then life is gone. Well, once that sun goes out, then what? All the planets, the life that revolves around it also dies as well. You follow?
Sure.
He was also pointing out, this is a... in the black book, right? This tablet? Okay. Tablet 2, it says in the beginning, that's what you were just talking about? Lo, in the very beginning was the word, existence was this word, and creation came after. And it says nothing would exist if Anu, Elion, Elion, El, didn't create it in order for Anu to create it. But of course, all the Anu and Elion, Elion, all that goes into doctrine as well. That was a stepping stone into us coming to the point in which we are now to know who exactly who these beings were.
So,
you know, something to wake up our DNA. Just hearing those names and those tonations is something that can wake up the DNA.
Okay.
Any other questions?
Yeah, for now. Why is it that African culture teaches that once your ancestors or loved one transition, they are still with you or still connected to you, yet in European religion or doctrine, they teach or program that you should forget and not be concerned with whoever has passed on?
Well, I mean, that's... I don't know how to explain it, but that's a hoax. That's a game play. That's for you to let your ancestors go. Forget them, turn your back on your ancestors and actually start calling on theirs by titles. And you start calling on theirs by titles of Jesus, God, you know what I'm saying, Zeus, whatever. As they push their cartoons of heroes, which is like Haru's. You know, and the thing is that each one of our pharaohs was a Haru, they were Haru, you know, meaning they had the same ambition and same responsibility as to be like unto a savior as the father, like Har was to in the likeness of his father Asar. But the thing is that what they do is tell you to drop your ancestry lineage Funny thing is that when you look into it, I don't know if you ever heard of the term cess, like cesspool, like blood. It's done with germination, genes, so forth, and blood. Your lineage. The thing is, they'll tell you incest is wrong. We're not talking about incest like for you to sleep with your sister, or, you know what I'm saying? We're talking about the reality of tribal and to lock things within families. And they broke that. And they did it first by the language. And you'll see that within your biblical standpoint of this God came down, found the languages, caused confusion. That was the first step. You know what I'm saying? Scatter the people. Then once other bloods come in, then it dimmies down or denotes the potency or the power, the second that's within your blood already as who you are. That's why he's teaching us about genetics now, and you hear many other leaders said it, like even Garvey said, you know what I'm saying? What's a tree without its roots? You know, it's nothing. It won't grow. So you have to connect to your roots to even know why you even stand here in this temple today. Someone in your bloodline was studying their spirituality, studying their people, and had inquiries about these things that were being taught to them that maybe did not identify with their everyday living, the everyday steps of life of their mother and father saying, respect me, listen to me. You know what I'm saying? Remember what your father told you, remember what your mother told you. But yet and still, once you go to church, instead of saying, don't listen to what your father told you, don't listen to what your mother told you, they are devils. You know what I'm saying? They yet and still say, pray to Jesus. Jesus is God. And without God, or without Jesus, you are not saved. You don't have anything. And your everyday protection was coming from your father and mother, or your guardians, as they call them, parents.
So a part of it being a trick to separate you from your ancestors and your own culture, your own way of life, was it also because they also feared your ancestors and they also did not fully understand
they feared-